Hi everyone, I'm Dr. Deepa. Welcome to my channel Together and Fun. Today we will look into the poem A Roadside Stand by Robert Frost. Robert Lee Frost, born in San Francisco, California, lived a life of contrast. He rose to the literary and cultural icon of America. Robert Frost's literary talent blossomed from his days in school. Robert Frost's poem, Stopping by the Woods in a Snowy Evening, has been translated to more than 100 languages, and millions of students read it all over the world to savor its philosophical undertones. For centuries to come, Frost's name and works will remain enriched in the minds of poetry lovers across geographies and cultural boundaries. The poet contrasts the lives of the people who live in cities and with those who live in the country. He highlights the plight of deprived villagers who are aching for some money to lead a prosperous life. The life of poor people is miserable because they are in paucity of money. It is only the money that can lift their living standards, but they don't have any. The poet wishes to relieve the rural people of the pain at one stroke. The little old house was out with a little new shed. In front at the edge of the road where the traffic sped, a roadside stand that too pathetically pled. It would not be fair to say for a dole of bread, but for some of the money the cash whose flow supports the flowers of cities with sinking and withering faint, the polished traffic passed with a mind ahead, or if ever aside a moment then out of sorts at having the landscape marred with the artless paint of signs that with N turned wrong and S turned wrong, offered for sale wild berries in wooden quarts, or crook-necked golden squash with silver warts, or beauty rest in a beautiful mountain scene. You have the money, but if you want to be mean, why keep your money and go along? The hurt to the scenery wouldn't be my complaint, so much as the trusting sorrow of what is unsaid. Here far from the city, we make our roadside stand and ask for some city money to feel in hand. To try if it will not make our being expand and give us the life of the moving picture's promise that the party in power is said to be keeping from us. It is in the news that all these pitiful kin are to be brought out and mercifully gathered in to live in villages next to the theatre and the store, where they won't have to think for themselves anymore. While greedy good-doers, beneficent beasts of prey, swarm over their lives enforcing benefits that are calculated to soothe them out of their wits. And by teaching them how to sleep, they sleep all day, destroy their sleeping at night the ancient way. Sometimes I feel myself, I can hardly bear the thought of so much childish longing in vain. The sadness that lurks near the open window there, that waits all day in almost open prayer for the squeal of brakes, the sound of a stopping car, of all the thousand selfish cars that pass, just one to inquire what a farmer's prices are. And one did stop, but only to plough up grass, in using the yard to back and turn around, and another to ask the way to where it was bound, and another to ask could they sell it a gallon of gas. They couldn't, they had none, didn't it see? No, in the country money, the country scale of gain, the requisite lift of spirit has never been found, or so the voice of the country seems to complain. I can't help owing the great relief it would be to put these people at one stroke out of their pain. And then next day, as I came back into the scene, I wonder how I should like you to come to me and offer to put me gently out of my pain. Now let's analyze the poem. The little old house was out with a little new shed. In front at the edge of the road where the traffic sped, a roadside stand that too pathetically pled. It would not be fair to say for a dole of bread, but for some of the money, the cash whose flow supports the flowers of city from sinking and withering faint. Someone from among the village folk had a shack beside a highway that ran to the city nearby. The man extended a shack to the front to open a makeshift counter to sell his farm items like berries or its squash. It was a small venture to make some little money to meet his needs. Caravans passed along the highway, but few stopped to buy anything from him. In fact, no one showed any interest in his items, even avoiding to cast a glance towards it. Even a fraction of money of the city dwellers were awash in eluded the shack owner. He vainly looked at the passers-by with eyes seeking attention. His counter didn't merit any traveler's curiosity. The polished traffic passed with a mind ahead, or if ever aside a moment, then out of sorts, at having the landscape marred with the artless paint of signs that with end turned and wrong and S turned wrong, offered for sale wild berries in the wooden quarts, or crooked-necked golden squash with silver warts, or beauty rest in the beautiful mountain scene. You have the money, but if you want to be mean, why keep your money and go along? No doubt the travelers belong to the well-to-do class. The glitz and glamour they are used to was singularly lacking in the wayside counter. Seldom did they look at it. If ever they did, it was more to express disgust at the poorly painted and poorly displayed north-south direction board. Clearly they remained aloof. The humble farmer's solicitous eyes had little impact on them. The farmer offered wild berries kept in antique-looking jars, the freshly extracted juice kept in not-so-enticing containers. The city folks passed the humble counter looked joyfully at the rocks and the mountains that stood in the backdrop, but felt it below their status to stop over to buy such fresh produce from the lowly grower's farm. Their wealth had made them blind to such humble but priceless offering coming straight from the field. The hurt to the scenery wouldn't be my complaint, so much as the trusting sorrow of what is unsaid. Here, far from the city, we make our roadside stand and ask for some city money to feel in hand. To try if it will not make our being expand and give us the life of the moving picture's promise that the party in power is said to be keeping from us. The sack stands as a blot against the beautiful backdrop of the greenery and the distant mountains. For the bloated travelers, the shack is a spoiler of the landscape. They avoid looking at the counter, unmindful of the desire of the humble villager's struggle to fight the hardships of life with a tiny portion of the cash from the traveler's overflowing wallets. The indifference of the wealthy city folks is clearly disgusting. The political power is clearly titled in favor of the city dwellers. It isn't the news that all these pitiful kin are to be brought out and mercifully gathered in, to live in villages next to the theater and the store, where they won't have to think for themselves anymore, while greedy good-doers, beneficent beasts of prey, swarm over their lives enforcing benefits that are calculated to soothe them out of their wits, and by teaching them how to sleep, they sleep all day, destroy their sleeping at night the ancient way. A new relocation plan for these poor villagers is in the offing. In the pretense of giving them the comforts of urban life, these simple folks will be forcefully uprooted from their land and made to live inside the urban limits, beside the theaters and malls. No one bothers to take their consent, nor to study how disoriented the village folks will feel in their new habitats. By sweat-taking the gullible rural flocks, the land sharks will fleece them from their ancestral lands and condemn them to live in the urban centers. Such trickery will never be called to account, and the villagers will painfully struggle to adjust to the new ways of earning a living. Undoubtedly, the change will bring them misery. Their simple lifestyle will be destroyed, and in their new habitat they will lose sleep, implying that life will become riddled with difficulties. On the other hand, the manipulators and the wolves in garb of benefactors will enjoy their lives in a greater luxury. Sometimes I feel myself I can hardly bear the thought of so much childish longing in vain. The sadness that lurks near the open window there, that waits all day in almost open prayer for the squeal of brakes, the sound of the stopping car, of all the thousand selfish cars that pass, just one to inquire what a farmer's prices are. And one did stop, but only to plow up grass. in using the yard to back and turn around, and another to ask the way to where it was bound, and another to ask could they sell it a gallon of gas, and couldn't, and they had none, didn't it see? The poet feels distraught. He knows he is expecting something that this cruel world can't deliver. This resignation makes him angry and sad. The humble farmer looks on expectantly at each and every passing car, hoping that they would stop and make some purchases. However, his wait remains futile. The passengers in the car seldom bother to stop near the sack. Buying anything from such a poorly exhibited stall is below their dignity. The humble farmer looks on vainly, hoping that he could sell something at least to carry home a little cash. At rare intervals, cars do stop, but it is either for asking some direction to the city, or taking a turn in his backyard, or for filling gas. The farmer's heart breaks when such visits, which are few and far between, do not result in any tiny business for him. The attitude of the wealthy folks leaves the poet exasperated. No, in country money, the country scale of gain, the requisite lift of spirit has never been found. Or so the voice of the country seems to complain. I can't help owing the great relief it would be to put these people at one stroke out of their pain. And then next day, as I come back into the scene, I wonder how I should like you to come to me and offer to put me gently out of my pain. The poet regrets that despite the enormous wealth of the country and its vast resources of earning, social welfare and concern for the downtrodden in rural areas have never been the national agenda. The conscience of the nations is muted and muffled towards the citizens who barely scratch a living off their lands. The compassionate poet dreams that he could, in one masterstroke, banish the sorrow and suffering of the toiling and deprived masses from the morass of poverty. But when the magic spell would get over, hard realities would bite. It would make the sagely poet sad again. He wants his readers to offer a helping hand to overcome the shock. The use of the personal pronoun shows poet's involvement and draws readers' concern. The poetic devices used in the poem are transferred epithet, metaphor, oxymoron, alliteration, and personification. Robert Frost feels an unbearable agony at the plight of the rural people who are ignored and neglected by the rich politicians. The government and the party in power are indifferent to their welfare. They fool them by making false promises and then fully exploit them to suit their own selfish interest. Food for thought. Why do you think the merciful have been called greedy good-doers and beneficent beasts of prey? Until we meet tomorrow, by this time, keep thinking. Feel free to drop in your answers and comments. If you are watching this channel for the first time, subscribe. If you like the content, like and share. If you want to watch more videos of this kind, enable the bell icon. Thank you.